Ahoy Arena in central Rotterdam played host to the 2014 BMX World Championships. Athletes, coaches, and fans from around the world came together to compete for the biggest crown in BMX racing, the UCI Rainbow Jersey. Known as the gateway to Europe, Rotterdam is home to one of the busiest ports in the world. It's also one of the windiest, so hold on to your hats as we take off and bring you one of the most surprising and eventful world championships in history. Attracting over 2,500 competitors ranging from the 5-year-old kids to the cagey veterans and up to the cream of the sport, the elite champions, this event has something for everyone. It's a tight and fast course, and that means full tilt bicycle motocross action.
Everything's actually riding good. The track flows really well. There's actually a few technical spots. It's short, obviously, but I think it's adding some difficulty to a few of the riders.
The heavy hitters like Liam, Maris, Sam, like the ones that are really quick down the first straight and to the bottom of the starter will go the ones this track kind of suits them more.
That track's a little tight. You know, I think that's what we all expected coming into this race, but I think it's better than last 2 years. It's a little more wide open. It feels like it's a little bit faster than the previous tracks. So overall, it's good.
Well, the track is fine for me. I think it's tight, but it's fun to ride. The turns are really good. It's a smooth, it's fast, technical, so I'm feeling good on it.
I think they've done a really good job with the track here. Obviously, it's a small indoor arena again, and they've done the best they can with the floor plan. Good track and good for racing, I think.
First rate is, definitely a win factor. So the guy that comes out first, out of the first turn, probably is gonna win the race for 90%. So everybody wants to be that guy, including me, so tough times coming up.
The challenge classes compete with a 5-meter starting hill, but once they're finished, the beloved hill is raised to its full 8 meters height for the elite and junior championship races. The riders come down the start hill and into a short first straight, then it's over 2 triples and into a brick line first turn.
It's a short first straight, and it's going to be important to be on the inside of the first corner in racing.
The first triple is tight, so you have to be really technical, going fast, but at the same time going low.
The first straight is really important to get inside lanes. It's quite short, but I'm feeling really good on the first 2 jumps. I've just got to get out to the kind of halfway down the ramp, and then I'll be fine.
It doesn't really suit me at all. Tight and technical without a first straight. I'd like an extra gap on the first straight to open up, and normally gives me a little bit of a buffer before I start getting into the technical stuff.
This track is all about the first straight. I think whoever's first down the bottom of the hill, you know, and then the lane choice is very important as well. I think on this track, lane 4 is like lane 8 on the regular track.
I don't know what order, maybe 1, 2, or 3, the 3 inside lanes, because from the outside it's really hard.
I like lane 1. I like it to be in the best one. I think is lane 1, to just choose a good gate and do it fast.
You just gotta let go and stomp it down the hill and hopefully get in on the inside of the first turn.
Coming out of the berm, the track splits into separate men and women's pro sections that promises to keep the crowd on their feet.
Second straightaway is pretty tricky. You have to really get that first one good, because if you tag it or overshoot it, you're right there into the next lip.
A huge step up vaults the men into the second berm, where the pro sections then rejoin as everyone hits the corner trying to avoid the carnage.
I think on these types of tracks, passing is usually pretty tough, but definitely the turns are pretty wide open, and I think we're going to see some moves in the turns for sure.
There are not many, but I think it's possible. Even in the first turn, if you're outside, there's a lot of room inside and going into the first turn. Same with the second turn. There's quite a lot of space inside. But if you have a clean, perfect lap, there's not many opportunities to pass through it.
Everything's so close, all the racing is so much tighter. All the inside turns, you have to pretty much be blocking because someone's there trying to dive bomb you for that one of those top 4 spots.
Flying out of the second turn, the riders hit the third straight, a triple jump and into the third berm, and then it's on to the finish line. It takes a mere 25 seconds to finish a lap. Blink and you'll miss it, so keep your eyes wide open and enjoy nonstop BMX action from this year's Quest for Gold. First up comes the time trials, where the top 16 men, 8 women, and 8 junior men run a super time trial final to decide the overall winner. This has turned into an epic battle where the winner gets to wear the rainbow jersey for the next season's time trial races. it was Aussie rider Sam Willoughby who took the win for the elite men with a jaw-dropping time of 24.757.
So I think I just went a bit wide on the first straight in that first one. I chose outside in five, and so this one I brought myself a couple of lanes more inside and chopped off a bit of time there, and then just made sure I flowed around the track and didn't push it too hard. And yeah, pretty almost knocked a second off on my first time, so that's pretty cool on a tight track like this.
Dutch rider and bronze medal winner at the Olympics, Laura Smulders, topped the women's side with a run of 27.449. Just 0.02 of a second faster than second place Caroline Buchanan.
Came over the finish line and heard I had the fastest time, so great feeling, but then I had to wait for Mariana to still do her lap, and I think she made a mistake somewhere because she came third in the second turn, so I was like, oh yeah, this is gonna be me winning.
The Dutch team then celebrated a men's sweep with Niek Kimmann topping the junior men's class, while French rider Sandy Thibault came first in junior women.
I saw the last few four guys all beat my time I had in the qualifying race, so I knew I had to step it up and made it happen.
I did some mistakes in the second one, but I felt good. Even with those mistakes, they got third.
Finished 11th place, so not the result that I wanted, but it is what it is. Racing is totally different, so everything can happen from there, and we'll see what happens.
It didn't actually feel that bad, but that goes to show that one tiny mistake costs a whole lot of time. Normally, if I'd done a lap like that on, say, Papendal or one of those tracks, it would still be a competitive time.
My first time trial was 10th, a couple of mistakes, improved on those, and actually took over half a second off my time trial and finished 5th in the end, so yeah, I was really happy with how I'm going.
I've never been a time trial guy really, so top 8 is good for me, you know, it gives me first Olympic in the 1A final, so that's all I was looking for, to be honest.
The time trial went okay. I made some mistakes in the super final, and that's the difference on this type of track. You know, everyone can ride it clean, so you have to have a really exceptional lap to be on the podium, and so I'm looking forward to racing today.
2013 world champ Liam Phillips of Britain is keen to keep his crown and has been training hard.
So since last year's UCI World Championships, I obviously was definitely the biggest race of my career and the biggest result of my career, and you know, it's been massive for me as an individual and also, you know, our program as a whole within GB. I certainly can't stress enough how important I see that jersey being, and you know, for me it's something that I've looked to win and wear for years. You know, it's been something that I've strived towards since I was a kid. I made a really conscious decision within my mind to wear that jersey as often as I could and wore it every day in training. Done that jersey justice, I think, and you know, as of now, it doesn't belong to me, it's up for grabs again. I'm looking at going out and winning that jersey, and it's something that, you know, I've been preparing for and looking forward to for a long time. You know, I think when it's all said and done, you're on the start gate and you're there racing to get 7 other guys, you can't help but treat it like a normal race. It's pretty straightforward for me. You know, it's something that I train and prepare for almost every day. It's BMX at the end of the day. You can be coming into these races in the best shape of your life and you make one mistake and your race day's done. I still, you know, look back at that race 12 months ago and you know, somewhat don't really believe that it happened, but you know, it's been nothing but great for me as an individual, and you know, I'm looking forward to racing this weekend and you know, trying to win that rainbow jersey again.
The qualifying motors are run in the morning to seed the riders into the main event. The lucky few that sit atop the 2013 UCI rankings don't need to qualify and are automatically seeded into the eights for the men and the quarters for the women.
It goes by last year's qualification and the UCI rankings or whatever, and then I wasn't going that fast last year. It was kind of my off year, and then here I am doing 3 motos. But it's actually a good warm up, you know. I don't mind, especially on this kind of track where it's short and then you don't really get that tired.
I went from lane 8 in the first moto and I just got kept out wide, and then I had the inside for the next 2, and it makes a huge difference being inside into that first corner. I didn't really get to experience the system last year because I was rolling off the gate with my broken arm at last year's World, so it's been good to kind of get the experience for next year when it's a little bit more important.
Motos went well. I won my first one, second one I was just on the outside and just kind of following for the two and took a 1-2-2. Good confidence going to the next round. Now it's one lap elimination, so it's time to get business going.
There are a couple of spots, like that second turn is, I think it'll start seeing some action now that it's cutthroat, top four. It's extremely wide open, but you have to go in there committed to coming out, so we'll see what happens.
Racing is coming up, 1-8 final, so just got to be on point, got to be sharp, and make sure you pass that line as first.
In heat one of the eights finals, Aussie rider Sam Willoughby kept his form and stormed into first place. In heat two, USA powerhouse Corbin Sherraw took an easy win, but a nasty crash on the first straight took out 2013 runner-up Mark Willers and French rider Sylvain André. Heat four saw the biggest upset of the day when Liam Phillips and Frenchman Damien Gaudet collided in the second turn, dashing the defending champ's hope of retaining his crown. David Herman went on to take the win. Proving you need more than just skill and speed, Liam Phillips had a chance to talk about why his day ended much earlier than expected.
I trained extremely hard for this race and was feeling, you know, the best that I've ever felt on my bike and you know, my physical shape coming into the race. And you know, I just wanted the opportunity to be able to go out and race for that jersey again, and you know, to have that opportunity taken away by what can only be described as a, you know, ridiculous move, then yeah, I just feel robbed, but yeah, it's the sport of BMX.
In heat six, more top-ranked riders missed the cut as Louis Breithauer lost control on the second straight, landing on Jordy Vanderheiden, taking them both out of the running. The other Dutch rider in this heat, Jelly Van Gorkum, had some problems on the second berm and also failed to qualify. American rider Connor Fields took the easy win in heat seven, but Kirk Picard lost it on the first jump, knocking out Bodie Turner, who in turn pushed Barry Nobles into the carnage. With the eights over, it was on to the women's quarterfinals, but let's hear from the 2013 elite women's champion, Caroline Buchanan of Australia.
Last year at the BMX World Championships in New Zealand, I came into it. I'd done a lot of mountain biking, had a little bit of a break after the London Olympics for BMX, and yeah, I guess you could say I had no pressure on me, just came in prepared and ready and walked away with the World Championship title. It's been huge. It was my fifth world title that I'd won, but this world title has been very different to the rest of them. This one's really been prestigious, I think. At an Olympic event, the one which everyone wants to get, they want to get that racing world champion stripes on their back. I think being a world champion comes with a lot of responsibilities, a lot of pressure. I do like pressure, I do like having a target on my back, but I don't think I really expected that just having that world champ title, been a whole year living with that, and there is a lot of expectations and pressures that you have to live up to. At this level, everyone's fast. All these girls are so quick now, and having that extra little bit of that mental edge on your competition, I think is a big key to BMX. It's been an amazing year, and I think coming to these world titles, now I'm just hungry to keep those rainbow stripes on my back. Just going to put myself in the position for me to be able to win, getting good times, getting good lane selection, and just really focusing on my gate. I think if you can win to the bottom of the ramp, you've got a really good shot of winning around this track.
Today's race, I'm better in race action. I win in my motos. Now we're going waiting for the quarterfinal.
Eight meters high, four groups, the women's elite quarterfinals stacked on top of the hill. The Diaz's Argentinians on the outside, but we're going to be looking for a snap from the American, Felicia Stancil, as they get it going, as their quest for gold starts right here. Oh, and a good snap on the inside. Felicia Stancil, not quite. It's Valentino with the pop, but here comes the American charging into turn one. The green helmet, where's Hernandez? On the inside, the right side with the yellow helmet. Keep an eye on the race between those two as Valentino tucks into the third, and a huge battle going on with Lauren Reynolds trying to stay relevant. Wow, what a pop on the inside. Oh, Felicia Stancil gets the bump as Hernandez puts the contact back in and takes the win. What a finish that one was. Will Smulders make it in? She won the time trial final, but not sure. The photo finish will tell the story in the first round. And it is Smulders, Reynolds, Stancil, and Hernandez with a definite move on that last turn to take the win out. And second round for these women going on to the semifinals. We're going to be looking for Caroline Buchanan in holding the world championship plate from last year. Watch for her start, and away we go. What a great snap on the inside. Look at that. Aussie. Away she goes. Fluorescent green of Caroline Buchanan of Australia. Brooke Crane staying close, and IU on the bubble right now. She tries to maintain some composure, but way out the back, it's McLeod from Australia in the third spot. Oh, the rhythm section moving bodies around, and it's Buchanan number one, Crane number two, and a battle down the last straight as IU makes the fourth and final cut. So it's IU, Christensen, Crane, and Buchanan moving on. All right, here we go. We're going up to the top of the hill for the third round. And Mariana Pajon has to be the favorite, but Magali Poche of France, always dangerous on the track. And never count out Vilma Remscheite. Here we go. And down the hill they go. On the inside, it is Pajon, Colombia, with the charge. Danny George not letting her get away right away. The blue and red of USA staying in the two spot. Poche in three. But what a collection of riders coming to try to get that last spot. Van Bentham goes under. She took advantage of the carnage. Valentino hanging on for the third spot, and it looks like Van Bentham, the Dutch rider, giving the hometown crowd something to get excited about as she makes the cut. And we'll go down a good shot of the first straightaway. You can see Pajon and Danny George with a bit of space, but behind that, Valentino was trying to hold off Remscheite, Nadia Priest, obviously into the carnage right there, so they're not going to make it through. That left five riders and four spots to go. Remscheite, unfortunately, now on the outside looking in. Another good shot of them. Carnage in the first turn. And an easy race for Pajon as she moves her way on. Van Bentham, Poche, and Danny George also moving on.
It's fun. I really like the track. It's good for an indoor track, and I'm feeling fast on it.
And here we go. We have a couple of ex-teammates in Elise Post and Amanda Carr, who now rides for Thailand, going head-to-head, and six riders on the track, four of them making the main event. All right, another Dutch woman on the outside with a bad start. That's not going to help her chances as the Beast bowling her way into the first turn. That's Elise Post with a good lead going on. Amanda Carr hanging in the mix. So Thailand right there, right behind the American. Elise Post had a tough year. She's battling back. Van Hoof of Belgium. Great to see the Belgium rider hanging tough as they come around. One more cobblestone corner to go. And onto the finish line, an easy race for Elise Post. Taking the win, Amanda Carr will get second, Van Hoof and Sarah Walker squeaking by. Then it was time for the elite men's quarters. Men's quarterfinal number one, back at the top of the hill we go. Four of these guys going on to the semifinals. It's Sam Willoughby versus Strombergs. Six other guys in there. It's going to be tough for those guys to crack the top two. And away we go. A great snap looking for red and white on the inside. And it is versus burgundy and white. That is the Willoughby and Stromberg show taking it out of turn number one. Some action and carnage in the cobblestone corner. But all about Willoughby right now as he and Stromberg lead the pace. And a great run right now. Colombia versus Japan in the mix. So only six riders left as they go down to the finish line. It will be all about Willoughby and Strombergs, but Resende and Oquendo making the cut. And carnage in that corner didn't feel good. Here goes Willoughby, and Strombergs playing it smart on the outside, just taking his time, watching the champ, taking the lead as they work their way around. Here, another good shot on the inside of the corner. Here's where things went down, and he unfortunately got smacked in the helmet twice on that run. But you know he's going to be back, but it'll be Oquendo, Resende, Strombergs, and definitely Willoughby moving on.
I want so much to go to the final. I never did final in the World Championship, in the Elite Men, and that's my dream for today.
All right, heat number two. Top of the hill we go. A couple of Americans to talk about, Shira and Cesar. Cesar could be coming into his form, but also the Frenchman in the mix a little bit, and Safiso Nalapo trying to stay consistent in the green and yellow, and a great snap on the inside, but it is Shiraz. We charge into the first turn, look for the dark blue and red of the Americans, the Frenchman in there, Mir, Amadou Mir staying in the mix, so a great run as the French team tries to stay in the mix, and Cesar in the middle, but slipping slightly as they go into the last turn. He gets the bump and high side, out goes Nalapo, and Shiraz and Cesar, the Americans, will make it through along with Amadou Mir into the main event. Another shot of the first turn, tight action. Hard to move around in that corner, you need some speed. Shiraz had it, Cesar had it, a little bit of a kick out there. And then Nalapo is positioning himself well, but Shiraz takes the big win and moving on to the semifinals. And that's the way it finishes. A bad day for Nalapo. He is out, so is Gaudet. And here we go to heat number 3-4. These guys moving on. Connor Fields, definitely the name to watch. The American, watch for Yoris Daudet, also running some pretty hot laps, and we're going to get a shot of the start hill from the top again. And the outside lane, not where you want to be unless you get some room, and he does on the outside. But here comes Fields with a trademark little kick out over the jumps. One, there he goes, two, and leads the pack quite handily as they go in. The Garcia gets the bump. Oh, that was some action on the backside as five riders, four spots coming down the last straightaway. Fields with a big win, moving on, tremendous, with a great lap in second behind. All right, here we go. First turn, Anthony Dean comes in, says thank you very much. Out goes Jared Garcia. Tried to fight his way back, but no luck for him. There's not a lot of room on a 25-second trap. So Ramirez, Dean, Tremenis, and Fields moving on.
I'd really like to make a final, but like as we know in BMX, anything can happen, really. It's just about trying to do the processes, do my a lap as best as I can each time, get a good start, and just try and get an inside lane every time, and hopefully that will take me through, but we'll see, time will tell.
And up to the hill for heat number 4, the last four guys to move on to the semifinals. It's gonna be a tough one, and we'll be looking at a couple of Americans, but don't count out Tori Nyhaug of Canada, and of course Quentin Calleron of France in the blue, dark blue jerseys. So here we go from the outside. The Aussie gets a snap. The yellow bike cannot miss those guys. The Americans on the inside. One, two, and three. It's North America in the lead right now as Tori Nyhaug trying to split up the Americans. David Herman running an awesome lap as he run through Posey in the mix. And away we go. It's all about North America. Look at Nyhaug splitting up the Americans, hanging in the third place, and that's the way it's going to finish. And a great run for Justin Posey, could be putting himself into contention as Herman, Nyhaug, Long, and Posey moving on. And after the men's quarterfinals come the semifinals.
It's actually a really fun track. I'm enjoying riding it. I feel good on my bike, and I just need to get a good start in the next race, and we should be in the final.
You need to be explosive to win the whole shot, and where you're in front in the race after it.
Here we go, elite women's semifinal number 1. Three Americans will be dotting the inside lanes, but watch for Stephanie Hernandez from Venezuela. She's pretty smart, and she's going to try to break that trio to get on to the main event.
Riders ready, watch the gate.
And a good action from the back of the start hill. Indeed, it is the Americans. Elise Post with a snap, and Danny George in the mix. So three Americans right now. Stephanie Hernandez not in familiar territory. Could be out of the mix. Australia trying to find their way, not getting through right now, but it's Post, George, and Crane. One, two, and three. Where is Hernandez? There she goes on the inside with a move and a great shot as she cuts off the Australian, and she's just going to make it in. So the three Americans as expected, and Hernandez moving on. We'll get another chance to look at that. She's got the yellow pants. She's in the middle of the Americans. Had good positioning, but then she got the bump. Look at the outside of the track, just about missing that straightaway. Lauren Reynolds in the mix. Ava Ayu already ahead of her at that point. but she played it smart, patient, and took the inside lane, took away Lauren Reynolds' chance of making the main event right there. That had to hurt. And for Stephanie Hernandez, awesome patience as she makes the fourth and final cut onto the main event. So quick summary, it's definitely going to be Hernandez just squeaking in, George, Crane, and Post running to the women's main event.
I'm just trying to give it my all out there and ride the best of my ability. I had no idea where I was at coming into this race, and right now it feels pretty good to be out front.
Here we go with women's heat number two, the last semifinal for these women going on to the main event. And this is a tricky round. You have Sarah Walker in there from New Zealand. She hasn't been riding well, but staying on the bubble, she could be a threat in this one if she stays consistent. There she is. And a good shot from the back of the start hill. As away we go. Does she have the snap? She's in the mix, but it's Mariana Pajon again on the inside, taking charge of the track. Smulders in there. What a group this is going to be as they're moving along. It's Walker still staying in the mix right now, but it's all about Pajon. Smulders and Christensen, a surprise. So Denmark in the mix right now. As we move it on, they could be moving on to the final right now. It's Pajon. We have the Dutch group moving on. That's Smulders. Christensen will do it. And Sarah Walker again just making the cut. Here's a shot of the first straightaway. And Sarah Walker not riding aggressively, but just enough to stay in the mix. Check it out. Here we go. Pajon. Smulders keeping her honest. And Walker using her long stature just to kind of stay away from the group. But definitely not one of the runaway races, so Smulders could be just sort of watching with Pajon, trying to figure out Walker, Christensen, Smulders, and Pajon moving on to the main event.
Well, I did a good gate. Feeling confident, I'm feeling relaxed, just having fun and doing my best. I'm already in the main, so I'm going to do my best. I'm going to do a good gate, a good lap, and that's it. I'm going to have fun.
And with the women's semifinals over, eight of the women's finalists are on to the main event.
I'd say on an indoor track like this, lane one, two, or three, or as far as inside as you can go, is definitely the biggest advantage.
Elite men's semifinal number one stacked in this situation. Willoughby, the inside lanes seem to be the dominant lanes. And we'll watch for that red and white, but a couple other riders there could play spoiler from the outside. And a big gate from the outside. Can he hold it? I don't know. Posey in the mix right now, but Willoughby taking it. Turn number one, one rider down. Posey is out. That leaves six riders, the Brazilian, Colombian, out of the mix. It leaves Willoughby in the lead. Tremendous and Nyhog, one, two, and three. Can they hang on? The Frenchman trying to retain the fourth spot. Will he get it right now? But Willoughby, it's all his race as he takes it in. Tremendous. A tremendous ride for him. And what a turn. Look at that. Thank you very much as Posey gets the bump in that turn, taking down South America in the mix. Five guys left after that. Broken parts moving around. And a good shot again. Wow, what a fall that one was. Here's what it looks like from the top as they go down the first straightaway. Tight pack as they go. Not a lot of room to move in there. And it was just a matter of running out of space. Posey got a bit of a bump. Down goes Resende, Ramirez. Five guys left at that point, and it was Mir, Nyhog, Tremendous, and Willoughby moving on to the men's main event.
Yeah, it's a good lap. Got a good start again, and just right at home. The crowd's awesome here, and you can hear them going off, so it's a great atmosphere, and one to go.
Well, it doesn't get more stacked than this one. Heat number two, four of these guys going on to the main event. Unfortunately for the other four, there's going to be some big names that aren't going to make it through. Corbin Sherrod definitely has the inside edge along with Connor Field. So watch those inside lanes, crucial on the short 25-second lap these guys are about to put in. And here we go for the gate. And a great snap on the outside. Trey White, not a bad gate, but can he get in? No way. Here goes Connor Fields. And it's Fields and Stromberg's one and two. So Stromberg staying in tight, one rider down there already. Fields managing this crowd, another rider down. And wow, what a big deal that's gonna be. Anthony Dean showing him a way to the cobblestone. Whoa, blown out Stromberg. Something happened in the last turn. Trey White says, thank you. David Herman's gonna make it through. And what happened? That is uncharacteristic of Strombergs to see that. So we may get a chance to look at the replay here, but he looks okay, a bit shaken up. And look at the gate on the right-hand side of Trey White. Not a bad start. Just no room to move over as he got the box from Herman on the outside. And Connor Fields just kind of ran away with it there. And one rider down there, not too happy about that. Look at Fields working it. Stromberg's just playing a smart lap once again. A big bump in that turn. Anthony Dean giving the elbows. And then a look at the last turn. Oh, there's a puff there. It looks like we may have blown a tire. Stromberg's may have lost the rubber on that one. And maybe that wasn't hit. It definitely was a blown tire, probably the front tire. And what a hit he took. Not expecting that to happen. We'll get one more angle on that one as we see it from the, there we go, the puff of dirt. And no chance of recovery on that one as Stromberg's now out of the mix. And Fields on his way to the win. So Anthony Dean, a strong lap. Trey White, David Herman, and Connor Fields moving on.
Yeah, it's been a long and tough year. And I just really was focused on just doing my absolute best and trying my best to kind of push everything around me out of my mind and just focus on myself and just executing to the best of my abilities. And so far, that's what I've been doing.
With the field cut down to the top eight of the day, it was time for the main event. First up were the junior women, where U.S. rider Shailene Reno has been riding well all season and has hopes of taking the win.
I'm feeling really good coming into this race. Very excited since this is my second year junior. The difference between racing challenge and junior elite is everyone steps up their game going into junior elite, so it's a lot more competition. I'm really excited racing down the big hill because I've only done it one other time on the UCI circuit. My preparation coming into the World Championships was riding with the other elite athletes and training with them. A lot of tough competition. Hopefully it'll be a really fun race. The sport of BMX has given me the ability to travel the world and race. I love all the competition and battling with everyone. I'm hoping to win this race this weekend. That'd be great.
Well, here's the future of elite BMX racing, some of them moving on to the elite group next year. One more chance at a world championship title, and we'll take it from the inside lanes for you. And this is a stacked group, and when we say stacked, six national champions. Here's one of them, Michelle Gonzalez, Ecuador, the Pan American champion. And here is the French woman who could do some damage, Sandy Thibault, French national champion. So, a lot of talent-laden women on this gate right now. The Russian champ, Bondarenko, Yaroslava Bondarenko. Look for a gate start from her. Hasn't been super strong off the gate. And here is someone who has. And she's going to be tough to contend with as we move across. And Shailene Reno is the U.S. junior champ. She's going to be one to watch. A Canadian in the final, probably for the first time in I don't know how many years. Awesome for her, Tatiana Kapanatova from Russia. So wow, there is going to be some Russian action going on in this main event. Great to see for their BMX program. Moving down the line, Rachel Smith, the Australian in the white, green, and yellow. Watch out for a gate start from her as we pan further across the gate right now. And from Italy, Camilla Zampese. She's the Italian national champion. So six of these women with a national crown and the weight of the world on their shoulders right now, and away we go, a snap. So Italy out of the mix right away. Who got the snap? It's Michelle Gonzalez on the inside. Ecuador right now leading the charge, and it's Shailene Reno in the third spot, so she's struggling. Russia doing awesome out there as Bondarenko holding off the American, but the American squeaks by Reno into the second spot, pushing the Russians back. And whoa, bumping in the last turn, but this one is all about Gonzalez, the Pan American champ, now the world champion, as Reno claims the second, Russia in for third and fourth. And a good shot from the gate start there right away. The Russian on the outside, not a chance, but on the inside, Bondarenko, a strong first turn as she stayed in the mix and relevant, going through the second straightaway. Now watch Reno. Every jump, pulling a couple more inches, goes on the inside. Smart move there. Blocks out the Russian, rides a huge rhythm section as the Russians start to come together on the last turn. Bondarenko trying to hold it on, but Kapitanova takes it over on the outside, managed to get a little bit of rhythm and move ahead for the bronze medal. But right now, it's Ecuador, Michelle Gonzalez, and a World Championship junior title.
I'm so happy for this. I trained really hard for this championship, and I gave all my heart.
Not excited to get it first, but pretty excited.
So great to see the Russians fourth and third. Reno captures the silver. Gonzalez gets the gold. So joy and happiness for Ecuador. Michelle Gonzalez with the win. Shailene Reno from the U.S., the silver. And Kapitanova of Russia, the bronze.
I'm Sean Gaian, 18 years old, from the United States, and I'm the 2013 Junior World Champ. Coming in to World Champs last year as first year junior, it was an exciting time. It was my first time off the big hill in front of the big crowd. Didn't really come as a huge shock to win the race, but I was definitely surprised, and I was really happy to do it, especially being only the second person to ever do it, Sam Willoughby being the first. So it was nice to almost make a little piece of history there. Putting on the rainbow jersey, you know, every time after winning the Worlds, it's kind of a surreal feeling. You know, you feel that you're representing your country. It's just a good reminder at like what you can achieve. Racing as a junior last year compared to challenge, it's definitely a big step. It's way more of a show. It's way more pumped up. It's way more serious. There's a bigger pool of really good riders, and it's just. It was actually really nice to kind of take the sport almost to a more professional level and feel like you're really doing a sport that matters. Going in as a second year, I've tried not to go in with too much different of a mindset. I don't really think of it as me coming to kind of keep my title. It's just trying to approach it as just another race, do the best I can. I haven't had the best preparation up to it, breaking my wrist at the last World Cup. So just here to try to put some smooth laps in and just do what I can. Going into the Worlds and being able to win back-to-back titles in junior, it's definitely at the end of the day, it's the goal. It would mean a lot to be able to win both years and kind of finish on the good stamp on your junior career. I would definitely be very excited to do that, and anything short of that here wouldn't be meeting the goals.
All right, we're set for the junior men's final. These are the future of elite men in the mix right now. Niek Kimmann, he'll be the favorite from the inside lane. That's the orange of the Dutch army. And wait till this crowd explodes. He's looking for a double Dutch win. And there he is on the inside. And again, that lane one, a huge advantage. As he gets the crowd going there, stands up. All right, that should get everybody's blood pumping on the gate right now. Christians Kriegers, the Latvian national champion, or junior champion anyway, as he lines up in lane number two, a great place to be if you get a good start. You can tuck into that lane one, and it's a great place to be. Sean Gain of the USA will be pressed here with a good start. The Americans known for their quick hole shots. So watch for the stars and the stripes in turn number one. Another Dutch rider in Jay Schippers. So a couple of Dutch riders in there. Could be the crunch situation if they're able to box out the American and the Latvian. And never count out the Frenchman, Xavier Bernard. Known for their bold moves in the turns. And also a countryman right next to him. Romain Racine making his way into the main event with a bit of consistency, a little bit of luck. Here he is, ready to do some damage. And as we move further to the outside, sometimes the chances do get a little less out here. Tori Navarstad, the Norwegian champion, and Walker Finch of the USA on the outside lane. A good gate start will put him in position, but he's going to need a little bit of luck to try to break that top three. And away they go. He got a bad snap. Something happened from the inside. May have broken a chain. He is out of the mix. Here comes Kimmann, the Netherlands. The crowd is on fire right now as they're running their way through. Gaian in the two spot, trying to find a way to catch the Dutchman. Looking for the double. It's all about the orange in the last turn. Gaian in the same position he was. Not a lot of room to move on this short track. And a Dutchman gets the double with Racine of France in the third. What a great run for him. And what a way to cap off a weekend. You'll no doubt see this guy moving into the elite ranks soon. Can he make an impact right away? I don't think he cares at the moment. He's celebrating a double world championship win as he got the crowds on their feet. And here's how it all started. He actually made contact with the Latvian, but so did Navrastad. They actually all had contact, so nobody got away clean. But right here, the Dutchman ran away with it. His Gaian tried to find some way to get in contention. A few bike lengths back, fought off the charge from Racine as they rolled their way down the rhythm section, but nothing doing as the Dutchman claimed his second victory of the weekend. And what a huge run as he wipes out at the finish line. And we get a chance to see the contact on the first straight. One rider down, away goes the Latvian. And another good shot. The Latvian just hit the inside, nowhere to go, and out of contention. And here we go around the last turn. And Niek Kimmann so excited about getting the double win. Here he goes, his only time that he's fell in the main event. There he slides into first with a world championship gold.
In practice this morning, things weren't going how I wanted them to have, but throughout the day, I felt I got better and better, and I can't believe it. It's hard to believe, like, I felt I could do it, but to make it happen, it's just amazing.
So Racine, Gaian, and Kimmann with a world championship win. He won the time trial super final. That makes him the biggest and fastest junior athlete of the weekend with the double. And always great to have a gold medalist in the hometown country. Away he goes. He's got the rainbow jersey with Gaian and Racine on the flank. And here's our chance to look at the gate of eight, the elite women's final coming at us just in a couple of seconds here. And we'll get a chance to pan across, but we're going to focus on Mariana Pajon on the inside lane. The Colombian has been unstoppable today. That inside lane has been almost unstoppable. Huge advantage for her. She had the world championship crown a couple of years ago. She's the reigning gold medalist from the Olympics with a big heart, naturally, and a big smile. Always looking relaxed until she gets on that track. And American Elise Post, a great race for her today. She's had a mixed emotional year of racing, back on track. And something to give the fans, a huge round of applause. Laura Smulders, the Netherlands represented in their home country. That's awesome for everybody, including their racing program. Simone Christensen, a great lap for her in the semifinal. Put her in the mix. She could be a contender if she stays in there. Sarah Walker, we mentioned before, not as consistent at the front top three, but always a contender. Hard to pass when she's out in front of you. Brooke Crane of the US, a favorite in this one. If she can get a good start in those middle lanes, you gotta get away. Danny George will have something to say about that as well. She knows it, she's confident, she's ready. And the outside lane, it takes a lot of energy to punch it out from there. Venezuela. Hernandez, she had a tough lap. She managed to stay patient and consistent. Could be a contender with carnage in the first turn. Oh, and a great start by the American to block Hernandez. So it's gonna be tough for her to come out. Pajon squeaks it out into turn number one. It could be her race. And what a race. Elise Post, two of the riders out already. Hernandez, not sure where she was going. Got forced into the men's section. Smulders, one, two, and three. So it's Colombia, US, and the Netherlands with a hometown crowd cheering. Smulders pulling it up, but it's all about Pajon as she takes out the win. What a race that one was. Again, lane one, a huge advantage. And a great gate start. Danny George got the bump. Hernandez never got off to a good footing. as Pajon right there in post. One and two as they went. She got the bump, moved out of that section. Christensen bumping those two riders out of contention. And that means no go. There was six left at that point. Pajon's race to lose. And there was nothing that Elise Post could do in her power other than wait for a mistake. And it's Pajon, a second world title in 3 years. And a huge win for the pint-sized Colombian.
It was awesome. Perfect lap. I was overjumping the first one and I did a perfect jump on this one. I just had to do a good first turn and that was it. Just running the track good and that was what I did. I can't really believe it. I've been training really hard and this is just payoff.
Didn't have the absolute best gate I'd ever had in the final, but I hung in there and a little bit of a replay last year in second. Didn't want to have those mistakes and got to the finish line. And for me, it almost feels like a win anyway.
And there is a good shot of your winner, Mariana Pajon. So a great result for South America, North America represented, and of course, Smulders with the bronze. Awesome for the hometown crowd. And away they go. The elite women's race their way into history once again. Five or less seconds from now, we're going to be crowning a new world champion in elite men. Eight riders have a chance from the inside. Connor Fields will lead the charge, and Sam Willoughby will be going from lane two, uncharacteristic by today, but Connor Fields had the fastest lap. And there's a good shot of Conman. You're not going to see a smile from this guy. He's ultra focused, very intense, getting ready for the race, and it shows in his riding style. Next to him, Sam Willoughby trying to figure out what to do and how to deal with Fields if Fields gets the pop on the inside. And a nice surprise, maybe a little bit. Edzu's tremendous, probably happy to be here. Latvia's happy, although Maris Stromberg's went out with a bang, literally. Probably bummed that he's not in here. And the Canadian crunch, Tori Nyhaug. If this guy gets a start, watch out, because he's tough. He's a pack rider. He knows how to pick people back in the race. Very smart. David Herman, always in the mix. Always a threat down the straightaway. And he'll be trying to push Nyhaug out. Amadou Mir, what a great chance to have him in the main event. The Frenchman all over the map these days. Not sure who leads the French team, but right now it's all about Amadou Mir. Trey White played it smart, played it clean, made his way into the main event. Great for Great Britain to have someone there. And from the outside, the Tasmanian Devil, Anthony Dean, not afraid to bump in the corners. Watch out for the wrath of his elbows as he comes all the way over for lane eight. Here we go. Herman, a great snap on the center. The 88 is great. The gate of eight is on, and it's Connor Fields and Willoughby. As we expected from the inside lanes, Amadou Mir hanging in the mix. Anthony Dean trying to stay relevant. Oh, a huge bump. Fields is down. Everybody's down. What a mix. The whole Fields is down. And Willoughby runs away with it for yet another world championship title. And wow, what a mix. Canadian Tori Nyhaug escapes the carnage. Who's in for the third? Trey White, Great Britain. So what a huge change. Here's a shot of what happened. David Herman boxed everybody out, but it was Fields on the inside with Willoughby in tow. Now watch Willoughby stay stuck on the inside. Fields tries to move him over. Willoughby says no way, goes early on the step up, shuts the lane, blocks Fields. Everybody's down. There comes Tori Nyhaug. So the Land Rocket picks up the silver medal, but Willoughby runs away with it. Aussie, awesome. And another world title for this guy. What a champ. As he takes a bow to the crowd, this guy owns BMX right now.
Yeah, a little off in the seam. I made a mistake down the second straight, and then obviously Connor rode a better lap, and he got lane one. And man, you need lane one on this track, on these indoor tracks. And I got out good, and I tried to move over and just overshot that second jump a little bit, and Connor got under, and and then there was, I knew there was one spot, and it was that second corner, and came here to win, so set myself up, got through that straight perfect, and was just close enough that he couldn't move over without hitting me, and just threw it in there, and it worked.
One of the craziest laps I ever raced, probably, on a track like this. You know, it's super tight, and you know, you need a lot of luck, honestly, and I had a fantastic day of racing, and had a bit of luck in the final, but you know, I'll take it. I had some bad luck last year in the final, so podium, especially coming back from a lot of injuries the last couple of months, it's a weight off my shoulders, and I'm stoked.
So what a final. It was a Trey White of Great Britain with the bronze. Nyhog captures a bizarre silver, and Willoughby runs away with yet another World Championship gold. And a chance to wear the rainbow jersey. That'll be a double for Willoughby as he puts on the stripes once again. And the riders a chance to reflect on the World Championships. That those that made it to the main event top three are pretty stoked. And for the rest, they get to get set for next year. But Sam Willoughby owning the podium with Nyhog and Trey White. Wraps it up for the 2014 BMX World Championships, where both elite title winners regained their titles from 2011 and 12 respectively. For 2015, we're staying in Europe, where the World Championships will take place in Zolder, Belgium. We'll see you then.